Oh, welcome this morning. I want you to know that you are the first church, other than my spiritual center back in Alabama, that I have spoken to since returning from my sabbatical. I took a sabbatical, a very extended, long sabbatical, for two reasons. One was to celebrate the milestone of my 50th year. And I know you're thinking, my God, he looks awesome. And secondly, yes. where did that come from? And secondly, was to do something that was on my bucket list. Do you know the bucket list? The list, things to do before you kick the bucket. And that thing had been on there for over 10 years, and it was to walk, to hike the Camino through Spain. If you don't know what the Camino is, it is an ancient pilgrimage in the Christian tradition that has been around, or at least documented, since the medieval times, as far back as the 10th century. And the people who have walked the Camino or done this pilgrimage range from every person like St. Francis of Assisi to Joan of Arc to horseback riding with Napoleon to Charlemagne to Cervantes to King Ferdinand and Queen Isabella to modern luminaries such as the Brazilian writer Paulo Coelho, who wrote a magnificent book about it called The Pilgrimage, and even the actress Shirley MacLaine, who also wrote a book about it called The Camino.
Much funnier.
And then there was me, who's also writing a book about it. But it was a remarkable experience. The most traditional route, there are many different routes, but they all wind up in the same place. But the most traditional route starts in this beautiful, picturesque village in France called Saint-Jean-Pied-de-Port. And you start in Saint-Jean, and you hike across the Pyrenees over into Spain, and then you walk the entire distance of Spain, all the way across the northern rim until you wind up in what's called Santiago de Compostela, which is a beautiful port city. And there in Santiago is the cathedral, which is dedicated to the apostle St. James. It's where his bones are interred. It's where he's been buried. And like I said, people for centuries after centuries after centuries have traveled this path. They say that the path is in the same directional diagram as the Milky Way. They say that the path has what's called ley lines, which are these energetic lines. And as I was preparing for all of this, I was trying to empty my mind of centuries worth of stories because I didn't want to compare myself to anybody else. And I didn't know exactly why I was doing it. I just knew that when I first read about it, something said, do this. You must do this. And it took 10 years for all of the elements to come together because it's quite something. So in total, I walked over 830 kilometers, which translates into roughly 517 miles. I did it in 34 days. I got tendonitis. I got blisters. I've lost two toenails. And my feet swelled in my boots and filled with blood. And I got fever one day. And I walked on the path staggering like a drunkard in the village. I had some woman from Norway come up to me and go, are you okay? And all kinds of things happened. But day after day, day after day, day after day, you establish this routine of simply walking. Of walking, of being with yourself, of listening to your thoughts. And you meet people from all over the world. So many people in Europe walk the Camino simply as part of their evolution in life. You see families. I was just stunned to see a mother and a father and their teenage daughter and their teenage son from New Zealand walking the Camino together. And in the first weeks when we were sort of on the same schedule and the same path, the kids had their iPods on, and they would look down, and they didn't want to talk to anybody. And the transformation that took place at the end of that, to see them engaged fully. I made friends from all over the world. People say, well, what happened? What happened? Tell me what happened. I got shin splints. My toenails fell off. There was nothing that was, you know, earth-shattering. The sky didn't open up. There were no visions. There were none of that. What it was a process of just being with me and a reaffirmation of what truth was. It was very subtle, and yet it was immensely profound. And as I walked on this trail day after day, as I contemplated, and as I dodged the cow pies and all of the different villages. You go through something like 300 different villages and towns and cities and hamlets, so much so that you forget all of the names, and I would try to frantically write everything down. But what I noticed was that I learned some very simple things, that life is not a race. Life is not a race. Why? Because there's no finish line. And as I would observe the rest of the pilgrims sort of hiking very fast and very furious throughout the day, it was because where you got to your final destination of the day, and it varied for different people, but let's say you're going to Santo Domingo. That's the village where you're going to stop at. And all of these villages are what are called albergues or refugios, which are the places that you sleep that are designated for the pilgrims. There's only so many beds. There's only so many bunk beds. And so depending upon how many pilgrims are in that section of the path, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people do this every year. So these people would become obsessed with, I need to get there because I want my bed. And that became their Camino. That became a part of their pilgrimage. And I thought, is that what you want your Camino to be about? I need to get there so I can get my bed. And I thought, no. I want it to be about what's around me. I want it to be about in the now. I want it to be in full observation. And so I let go in like the second day the need to have to rush in order to have a place to sleep. And you know what happened? By letting that go, I always had a place to sleep. I let go of the idea of where am I going to eat? I let go of all of that kind of stuff, and I simply trusted that if I ultimately believe that I am divinely taken care of, that all of that will synchronistically unfold for me, and it did. And I realized that so was the heritage of every pilgrim, every person that had ever walked this path. Why did they walk it? Why were the people walking it today? As we talked about it and we shared and we laughed over communal meals or wherever it was that we would sleep, people would say, I don't know why I'm here. I'm just here because something said you have to do this. I'm just here because I'm in a transition in my life and I don't know what's next. And I wasn't able to hear while I was in my own personal environment. I thought maybe I can hear what that will be on the Camino. And so you started to see a common denominator. People at a next evolution in their life. People looking for a deeper connection. And you suddenly began to lose all sense of the outside world. And you start to see how simple life is. That first day when I traversed over the Pyrenees, I had 3 books in my backpack. I had way too many changes of clothes. And what's so funny about the second day is that you start seeing pilgrims throwing away all this stuff. And the books, you know, I love books. And I'm like, ah! And I just left them there. And it's a great metaphor for life about how we hoard things. And we do that sometimes from this idea of not enoughness. And all of the sudden, as I begin to walk each day, I go, do I need this? No, I don't need this. You stop wearing deodorant because it weighs 1.3 ounces. And that 1.3 ounces is really heavy. And because everything that you own, everything that you use, everything that you live from is on your back for 34 days. And so you become very aware of what do I need and what do I not need. You become very aware of being in the now moment when you realize, oh, it would be nice to have, And all of a sudden you think about that, and that thing appears.